the amount of data. So here is a picture that you see, and I've labeled on it all these powers of 10, okay? Gigabytes, terabytes, petabytes, exabytes, and zettabytes, okay? So on the bottom of the slide, it shows, of course, the powers of 10. So it goes from anywhere from 10 to the sixth power, which is megabytes. So on the lower left corner, you have gigabytes, which is 10 to the ninth, right? And then you have terabytes, petabytes, exabytes, zettabytes, all incremented by a factor of 1,000. Okay, so the amount of volume of data right now is now going to be measured in exabytes, zettabytes, and so on. So there's a lot of data, all because of IoT, because of mobile technology like cell phones and so on. Okay, the other thing that is enabling AI is because now the computational power of the chips, okay, is much more powerful than before. Before, everybody, of course, using Intel CPUs, right? Central processing units. Now people use for AI purposes like GPUs, which GPUs actually mostly made by NVIDIA. They initially started as a chips to enable game, you know, like electronic games that people play. And now they found out that actually GPUs are really the best thing that it is for handling power processing. Okay, so that's what people they use now. So comparing GPUs with CPUs, you see at least 10x performance and also 5x in energy savings. So you have NVIDIA, and of course NVIDIA is not the sole player in terms of hardware. You have also Intel's Nervana, which is a dedicated AI processors. You have Google, which has Tensor Processing Units. Okay, these are all names that they use. IBM, Power AI chips, and even Microsoft. Okay, it leverages FPGAs. So from the standpoint of AI, if you look at the bottom of the slide, okay, it has a timeline. So AI has been around since the 1950s, okay? And somewhere, in the 1990s, machine learning was hot, okay? And right now, of course, people talk about deep learning. Okay, so that's the most rightmost figure here. Okay, what is deep learning? So just so that at least when you walk out, at least you'll be dangerous enough, you'll know what it is, okay? Why do the people call it deep learning? So if you look at the picture, okay, first of all the neural networks, they try to imitate the brain, the human brain. So the reason why this is called deep learning is that if you look from your left to your right, the left are the inputs, the right side you have the outputs. In between, you have many, many layers of what you call it cells, or in the human cases, like you have neurons, right? In this case, you have a computational network. And if the number of layers is many, many meaning say more than 3 or 6, okay? It can go to hundreds. But as the number of layers increase, that's why it's called deep, it's because it has many, many layers, okay? So like you can envision your lasagna, right? You have many, many layers of pasta there. And each layer basically figures out either, is it let's say you take a photo. A photo can be, separated into dots, lines, right? Curves, and finally parts of the picture, all right? So each layer handles different. Now, just to mention some of the names in terms of deep learning. So you heard about CNN. So this is not the cable news that I watch every day, but it stands for convolutional neural networks. Okay. Unfortunately, this morning, because of the time limit, I don't have time to go over each of them. But so you at least you have mentioned what they are, because a lot of the slides that comes next in terms of talking about trends, you need to have this reference. Otherwise, you don't know what they mean. Okay, recurrent neural networks, reinforcement learning. Okay, this is the thing that powers the AlphaGo machine, the deep mind, the one that beat the Wei Qi, the Go champion, right? It's based on reinforcement learning. And besides deep learning, which is really the number of layers in the network, you can also talk about very, very tall and very broad. Okay, so that's another thing called wide learning. Okay, so many applications, I won't dwell too much on this slide. Everybody, I just mentioned at the beginning of the talk, is AI is going to be impacting every aspect of life. Okay, so right now, the main applications that you see currently are focused on these few areas, like manufacturing, okay, like for example, in the form of robotics. Okay, you have retail, you have healthcare, which is a personal medicine, financial technology, fintech, and also utilities. Okay, so now I'll get into what are the current trends. Current trends, circa 2018. I'll go over some of them more in depth, but some of them I'll just skip them because of time, okay? So let's start with first one, deep learning, okay? So there's the thing about AI that people says, okay, well, now the machine is actually smart. And the machine may come up with a conclusion or a recommendation. People really don't know how did the machine actually arrive at that decision. You know, so the how it did it and why it came up with the thing, people are still trying to figure out. So I think that throughout the course of this presentation, you're going to see that one of the objectives that people are trying to work on is to try and understand the algorithms better, not from the computational and from the computer science standpoint, but how does the machine actually arrive at this recommendations or answers. Okay, so one thing, for example, is that is really new, capsule networks. Okay, so before we had this thing called CNN, convolutional neural networks. Okay, so if you look at the difference between now the capsule networks versus the previous generation convolutional neural networks is that if you look at that picture on the top, you have a facial figure of a face, okay? In the first, on the two that you have is that on the left side, you have the normal face. On the right-hand side, in this case, particular case, is that the mouth is actually on your forehead, okay? Now, using CNN, it won't be able to detect that this is not a face. So it will think that both of them are a face, okay? While using the capsule networks, it will figure out that actually the mouth should be on the lower part. And therefore, the one, the figure on the right is not really a face, okay? So this is like just in figure, in a picture form, what the difference is. Okay, deep reinforcement learning. Besides the fact that I mentioned that this is actually the algorithm that powers AlphaGo, the machine that beats the human champion in Go, is that now it can be trained via simulation. Okay, I don't know whether people know how much you know about the AlphaGo machine. The reason why the machine is almost unbeatable now is because the machine can, okay, a human can play, how many games do you think a human can play per day? Okay, probably at most 3 or 4 games a day because the person has to eat, the person has to sleep, the person gets tired, right? Well, the computer doesn't get tired. So it can play 24 hours a day, right? 7 days a week. And it can play forever. So it accumulates the information, the experience, and the knowledge on an unbounded basis. Okay, the other thing that is also a new technology is called the GAN, Generative Adversarial Networks. In this case, it actually has two machines working in parallel. One machine generates the data, okay? Because one of the problems about AI is that it needs a lot of data. And sometimes there's insufficient data in the world. So you need to have a generator that generates data. And then there's another machine that's called the discriminator that evaluates the data, where the data is actually a fake data that's created by the machine versus the real data. Okay, lean and augmented data learning. Okay, so there are two ways of also generating data. One is by doing simulations. Okay, you run a simulation and you create some new data. Okay, and then you can do also interpolation and so on. The other one is to transfer knowledge from one domain to another domain. And that's another way to creating the data. Okay, the other thing is that a lot of the applications that people are trying to use AI on are really uncertain, right? So there's a uncertainty, or it's a probability based. So you need to have more methods that can work with AI so it can handle where it is deterministic or probabilistic situations. Okay. And of course, once you have that, is the next thing, this is in every solution in every field, is that because you have more than one method, sometimes the best is actually a combination of them. So that's what they call hybrid methods. So you have GANs and you have DRLs and so on. And sometimes you can apply a combination of both. Then you can leverage the strengths of each of the methods. Okay. The other thing is about automating the whole thing. So people talk about robotics, and you say, well, Tesla, you know, Tesla factory manufacturing, the Model 3, is all mostly automated. You know, they basically, you have robotic arms assembling the car. Well, since one of the major problems about AI is that there's never enough data, wouldn't it be nice to have an automated data generation, okay, machine? So that's what automated ML, okay, ML is machine learning. With this is the thing that it will enable the democratization of AI. Okay, democratization means that everybody can participate and benefit from AI. You don't have to be an expert in AI. Okay, I mean, that's really the crux of the matter, right? And we'll talk about why that is also a big issue. Okay, digital twin, I'm going to skip it, but digital twin is basically you have a virtual. So you have like siblings. One is the real one and one is the virtual. But the virtual copy is very useful because if the real one is not available, you can supplant with a virtual one, and then you can do still the general operation and the systems because it sort of replaces the physical entity. Okay, and this one, I think basically we just said the same thing is that we want to make AI more transparent, more understandable, so that people understand what the machine is doing, and therefore the people have more trust in AI. And with more trust, then more people will be adopting more AI. Okay. Okay. So those are some of the technology-related trends that hopefully at least you heard about it. There, I'm talking about a few more trends that are also related to AI that are less technical. So one of the things is that the demand for AI talent is basically, there's just too much demand for AI experts because almost every endeavor now requires they would like to implement some of the advances in AI into the technology, where they are in retail, where they are in medicine, where they are in energy and so on. So there's not enough experts to go around. A radio station locally interviewed me about a month ago. They say, well, why is this happening? And I said, it's very simple. How long do you think it takes to graduate a PhD student in AI? Normally it takes about 4 years to get a PhD. And how many people do you need, actually? Everybody needs an AI expert. Okay, maybe at least one person in the company. So you can think about the demand. It's just a very large demand. Okay, but there's only every 4 years you have one PhD, and so on. Okay, so That's the reason why the salaries of these people are really very high, because they're trying to lure a lot of people from academia, from universities into the industry, try to work, you know. We heard about Alibaba and all these major companies. Everybody is trying to hire AI experts. The thing is that if you look at the salaries, so I have two reference points. On the left side, you see, for instance, that you heard about DeepMind. DeepMind is the company, British company that got acquired by Google, that actually had the machine called AlphaGo that beat, you know, the world champion, right? Okay, well, if they say that if you look at the number of people in that company and the average salary, then it comes out to about 350,000, okay, for all the experts in that particular unit. Likewise, China is actually investing a lot of money on AI, and they're actually trying to hire people, a lot of people from the US back to China, okay? And you can see some of the quotes in terms of the salary that they're making or they're offering. They are almost in the $500,000 range, I know. Okay, so last slide. So I've basically given a little bit about an overview of what AI, okay, and all the aspects of AI. And of course, AI is a crucial component in order to enable any digitization of any company. Okay, that's to become digital. AI is already working in many different areas. We already have AI in many aspects, including like Netflix and so on. Okay, that makes recommendations about what movie to watch and so on. Okay, the AI, as one of the previous speakers also mentioned, is that all the core emerging technologies. So you take AI, okay, then you hear about big data, then you hear about IoT. Then you hear about blockchain, right? All these technologies actually will be working together. So it's not like there's only advancements in one area. Not only there's advancements along that particular track, but they also get compounded because they're also working with all the other aspects. Okay, the clear example is the smart city where you need all of them, right? Okay, so what's next? I mentioned that the next ultimate goal is to make the machine generally smart, not just like good at playing Go or good at playing chess or good at making recommendations on one of the things, but actually just like us humans. Okay, we need to be smart on every aspect. Okay, so that's what they're working on, is general AI. I don't have time to go over it because this is probably a theme for another talk. But there's also a lot of worries about AI. Okay, you have a lot of people, like famous people, like Elon Musk and Bill Gates and so on, and Stephen Hawking, who recently passed away, that says, what happens when we reach the stage where about the last one called super intelligence, when the machines are actually smarter than human? Okay, so, but that's a thing for another talk. Okay, thank you for your attention.